In the year 2000, South Korea was officially labelled as an ageing society, which was defined by the UN as having 77% of the population aged 65 or older. Just 17 years later, in 2017, that number had jumped to 14%, and Korea was officially designated an aged society by the UN. More concerning than that figure is that almost half of those senior citizens live in relative poverty, the highest among the 34 OECD countries. In comes today's guest for Touch Basin's Whole, Mike Kim, who's been raising awareness of the elderly poverty issue with his non-profit organisation, the Korea Legacy Committee. And I'm glad to say that we have Mike in the studio with us today. Welcome to the show.
Thanks so much for having me.
So Mike, let's get straight into it. Can you tell us about the Korea Legacy Committee? Who's involved and what's it trying to achieve?
Absolutely. So in a nutshell, the best way to describe the Korea Legacy Committee is that it is a movement, and this movement has two goals. One is to raise awareness that we have this elderly poverty epidemic happening right now in our country. And then number two is to activate this generation to give back. And so we do that in two ways. One is we do volunteer events every single month where we bring young people together to serve and to take care of our elderly. And then number two, we try to raise as much funds as possible to be able to provide those meals.
So I want to know more about you as well, actually, because you're ethnically Korean, but you didn't grow up here.
No.
You grew up in San Francisco. So how do you end up coming here and setting up this committee? Were you always interested in this elderly poverty issue?
Sure. So I was born and raised in the Bay Area, studied political science, and actually I never thought I'd end up living in Seoul. But fate had it where I had been in Silicon Valley for a little over 10 years, and my heart wanted to join a startup in Korea. And at the time, there was a small company called Paedari Minjok, and I was
so intrigued. No longer a small company.
No longer a small company, but I was super intrigued. Mm. And I loved the vision that the CEO had. Mm. And so that brought me out to Korea, and ever since then, I've just fallen in love with living here, and I don't see myself going back. But to your question, giving back and philanthropy has been incredibly important in my life. And while I lived in San Francisco, I was blessed to be able to start an organization called the GLIDE Legacy Committee. And the GLIDE, the name GLIDE is because in San Francisco, the largest nonprofit that supports and takes care of the homeless is an organization called the GLIDE Foundation. And so I built that organization, and it's very similar to the KLC. It gets young people activated to give back to their community. And actually, the GLIDE Legacy Committee is going to celebrate its 10th year anniversary this October. And so when I came to Korea, I actually didn't know about the elderly poverty epidemic. Mm. But, you know, one morning I was in a subway station, and I'll never forget. It was the dead of winter. It was super cold. And there was a harmony sitting on a cardboard, essentially a cardboard box. And in front of her, she was not selling packs of gum. She was selling sticks of gum. And I was cold, and I wasn't padding. And she was out there all day. And that really got me thinking about how, in this country, where we have so much, that someone would be in that position. Mm. And the more research I did, it struck me that we actually have the highest level of elderly poverty of OECD countries. Mm. And as I looked around, there were little to no youth movements supporting that. And so because I had the history of developing the GLIDE Legacy Committee, I knew it was my responsibility to be able to build something to support elderly like that. And now we're at our fourth year.
I briefly gave some statistics in the introduction, but you said you did your own research into finding out more about this issue. Can you explain to our listeners how serious this problem of elderly poverty is in Korea?
I actually think that the elderly poverty epidemic is the largest socioeconomic issue Korea will face moving forward. I know that we're dealing with many issues, whether it's unemployment or, you know, high tensions in terms of politics. But right now, nearly 50% of the elderly people in our country live below the poverty line. Mm. We also are one of the fastest aging countries in the world with very low birth rates. So you have this kind of very strange two dichotomies here, where the number of elderly people are going to continue to grow. I think the latest stat was by 2060, so in 40 years, nearly 40% of our nation, of our Minjok in a sense, will be elderly, and many of them living below the poverty line. So this is a huge issue. If you are born in this moment, if you are a high school student right now, or you are a 40-year-old right now, this is going to affect you in terms of your daily life, what you're going to see along the streets. And so I think this is one of the most critical issues we have to confront.
Perhaps some of the clearest evidence of the seriousness of this issue in Korea today is that we have the highest suicide rate among the elderly in the developed world as well. And that's had some link with this poverty issue as well, and especially more serious, it seems, in the rural areas, right?
Yeah, actually, it's terribly sad. And what happens is, you know, with the number of elderly increasing, many of them often feel alone because they're living on the outskirts. Living in Seoul isn't quite expensive. And so many of the elderly are resorted to moving outside of the Seoul into more rural areas where they are lonely. And that mental health issue starts to come in, and they don't have the proper resources. And unfortunately, that results in high levels of suicide. And so it's an incredibly disturbing, sad fact. And I'm worried that those numbers will actually only continue to increase.
So you said the KLC, your committee, has been running for 4 years now. How has it been received? Do people get it? You know, are young people really getting involved?
Looking back now, yes. When we first started this this movement, in a sense, it was tough. I'm not going to sugarcoat it. When I think it culturally, this philanthropic culture of young people stepping up, giving back, is a little bit different between the States and Korea. And so when I first approached my friends and said, let's start this movement, let's start to have charity events, let's start to activate, there was a little bit of confusion as to, like, how do we do this? But I could say confidently now, though, that this movement is rolling. And what I'm really excited about now is that after 4 years, we've been operating with one chapter, and now we're scaling. And so actually, I'm very proud to announce that we've actually opened up four new college chapters. So Yonsei, Chungang, and two other universities have opened up their own chapters of young people coming together to give back once a month and raise money. And so my goal is to be able to scale this all throughout the country. And I can confidently say that this will be the most influential youth movement in this country.
It's really been fueled by that young energy as well, hasn't it? Because if you look at the board members I saw on the website, the oldest people seem to be like in their 30s maybe. Most of the board members seem to be in their 20s, right?
Absolutely. And this is something that was built by, powered by, and will continue to be grown by young people. I feel that that's the responsibility that we have as a generation, to give back to the generation that gave us so much. You know, it's sometimes I think we take for granted some of the things that we have now in 2019 Seoul. You know, just one generation back, my father remembers Myeongdong having a hukgil, I mean, a dirt road. And it's just incredible to think. A generation before that, we barely had bridges that took people across the Han River. And because of that generation that worked so hard to build the foundation of this country, it is now, I think, our generation's responsibility to take care of them.
The argument with the current generation, though, it seems that they say they are struggling themselves. The Korean economy, they say, is struggling. Everyone has to work so hard to make money and look after their families. And the elderly, they always tell us to not worry about them, that they'll be all right, to worry about yourselves and worry about your own family. You don't buy that argument, though, do you?
Well, when it comes to philanthropy, I always think this. It's not something that everyone has to do, but I do believe everyone has a responsibility to give something back when you want to and when you're comfortable with it. I know that a lot of the young people right now are struggling, and that is their main concern, and it should be. But I also know that there are a lot of young people that may not have that financial difficulty, and they do have the time to give back. And so I'm not saying that every single person who is young right now has a responsibility to give back right at this moment. But I do think that there is a certain part of our youth population that may have the time, that may have the means to give back. And if we all just give back a little bit, just a little bit, we can make a huge impact on this epidemic.
So how do you plan to move your organization forward now? What kind of plans do you have in place?
So as we continue to raise money, part of that is to be able to help us scale. And so we are actually taking our opportunities to meet young people in every city of this country. So earlier this year, we went down to Busan, and we met a lot of people there, and we picked the Busan chapter director. We're going to go to Daegu, Daejeon. This epidemic is not just a Seoul epidemic. There are elderly people all over this country that need help. And luckily, there are young people all over this country that have huge hearts that want to give back. So from here on out, it's basically our committee taking the time every weekend, taking a KTX ride or a bus ride, to get to new cities and to spread this movement. And, you know, the reason why we call it the legacy movement is that if we do it right, in a sense, I won't see the success, because this is a movement or a philosophy that should go on way before or way longer after I pass away as well. This is a belief that every young person has a responsibility to give back. So my job is just to continuously recruit more young leaders, build this system of giving back, and we're going to continue to build this until my last day.
So this is about not just helping the elderly people right now, but building a foundation for the future generations to think about this elderly poverty problem and to plan for them in the future as well.
Absolutely. You know, that's why people used to always ask, is this a nonprofit and what kind of organization are you? And I've always said that this is a movement. And in a movement is really a philosophy of how one should approach their life. Mm. And so the KLC movement is about developing and building that legacy, that philosophy of giving back every day to your community, thinking about how to improve your city or your community or your country. And this is something that we're going to continue to build for the next few decades that I'm going to be here.
And if people want to get involved, where should they go to find out more?
The best way to do that is to like us on Facebook or to follow us on Instagram. That's where we make updates on our volunteer events, which we do every single month. And then every 3 months, every quarter, we put together a charity event. And our biggest event is coming up in October. It's our annual gala. And so I really encourage everyone to please join us. It's a really special night. It brings together the entire community. And most importantly, it raises awareness and funds to support the elderly of our country.
So it's a gala. It's an open event then?
It's an open event. It's a young professional gala. And I don't think there's many of those in this country. And when I first started this, I think there was a lot of skepticism. It says, you know, young people are not going to wear a tux. They don't have a gown. And, you know, you're being too Western and you're bringing this culture. But here's why I'm a stickler for why it has to be black tie. One, and why it's reasonably priced. You know, for a black tie gala in San Francisco, it's going to cost you $500, $400 for a ticket. This is $80 for a young professional like you and I, and it's $40 for a college student. And I enforce that because not only is it important for us to raise money, but it's also important to break the myth that only rich people and only someone from some chaebol family can give back. Anybody who has the means, whether you're a college student or a young professional, can give back. And the reason why I want it to be black tie is, you know, you and I have the same personality sitting in this chair, but the second you put on a black tie tuxedo and the second a young woman puts on a gown, they feel different. And that's confidence. And I think right now this generation more than ever needs confidence in themselves. And so this gala is not only about raising money, but showing young people you are just as important as anyone else in this country. You have the means to be able to participate in a black tie gala at the Four Seasons. And it's a night of empowerment for young people. And so it's open for all, and anyone in this country can come.
We've been speaking to Mike Kim, the founder and board director of the Korea Legacy Committee. I think you're doing some wonderful work here, and I wish you all the best going forward. Thank you for making the time to come to the studio today.
Thanks so much for having me. I appreciate it.